Good evening, everyone. My name is Carla Durand, and on behalf of the Collegeville Institute, I am pleased to welcome each of you to this evening's lecture titled, Is Depression a Sin? A Christian Interpretation of Depression. Research shows that more than 30% of Christians with mental illnesses report that their churches made them feel that their conditions were the result of sin. Tonight's speaker, Dr. Jessica Coblentz, will help us think more intently about this research as she introduces popular and academic Christian interpretations of depression and argues for an alternative theological interpretation that moves beyond sin and evil. A few words about Jessica. Jessica received her BA from Santa Clara University in California, graduating summa cum laude. She received her MTS from Harvard Divinity School at Harvard University, and her PhD just recently in systematics from Boston College. So I think this is probably the first time we can introduce her as Dr. Jessica Coblentz. Congratulations. Jessica is a resident scholar at the Collegeville Institute and will be with us through the end of this academic year. Next year, she will begin teaching at St. Mary's College in Moraga, California. So please join me in welcoming Dr. Coblentz.
Is this mic working?
Yeah,
okay, good. All right. So thank you all so much for being here. It's a pleasure to share this work with you. And before I sort of dive in, I owe a huge thanks to the Collegeville Institute, to Carla, to Don, Kathleen, Viv, who isn't here. It has been an incredible year here with them and with all of you. As Carla said, I just defended my dissertation last week on Thursday. So I was back in Boston seeing friends and mentors, and they were all asking me about my experience here. And I told them, of course, that it was incredible. But one of the things I found myself saying was that I sort of came to Collegeville, Minnesota for the quiet and all the time, which are necessary things for dissertation writing. But the thing that I am sort of walking away with that I did not expect was the importance of community, which I should have anticipated would be so present here at a Benedictine place, but I didn't really know it till I lived it. And I experienced the importance of sort of leisurely conversation with friends who could sort of help me unwind from this difficult work, but also the importance of conversation partners. And it's really a joy to me to see so many of my conversation partners from throughout the year here tonight. And sort of in that spirit, I hope that this can be a continuation of the conversations that have already informed so much of the work that I've done here. So I want to try and use this clicker. We'll see if I last. All right, I want to start off to sort of usher you into my research by talking about one of my favorite gospel stories of all time. The story from Luke's gospel of Jesus meeting the disciples on the road to Emmaus. I imagine many of you are familiar with the story. The story starts out in a time of crisis. Jesus has been crucified and buried, and on the morning of this event, this encounter, some of Jesus' followers have discovered that his burial tomb is empty, which is just making matters all the more worse, of course. Some of Jesus's female followers start to connect the dots and recall that Jesus said something about rising from the dead. Maybe this is how we should explain it. They go and tell the 12 disciples, at least some of them. They're much more skeptical as a group. I think in one of the translations that I read, they sort of dismiss the women's theory as idle tale or something like that. So some of these skeptical disciples head out for a 7-mile walk from Jerusalem to Emmaus, this town. And along the way, they start talking about sort of how sad and confused they are. They're confused because everything that they thought they knew about their Jewish faith, about Jesus, their teacher, who was the Messiah, who was gonna sort of rescue them after waiting for generations for somebody to do this for the Jewish people, everything they thought about that no longer seemed to be true. And as they're talking about this, a stranger butts in, right? And asks them, what are you talking about? And they explain all this to him, and he has the audacity to sort of offer another interpretation of the story, right? He starts at the beginning, the text says, starting with the Pentateuch, and goes through the Jewish scriptures and offers another theological interpretation in light of the sort of crisis, in light of these sort of terrible experiences that the disciples have just encountered. So compelled are these disciples by this man's sort of theological reinterpretation of their faith that they say, why don't you come to dinner with us? We're not done with you yet. So they sit down at dinner. As they break bread, of course, they realize this stranger who has offered them a sort of reinterpretation, a new sort of theological account of their faith, is none other than the risen Christ, right? So as I said, this has always been one of my favorite gospel stories, but it took on a new importance for me, actually, when I started doing this research 3 years ago on theology and depression. A reason why it became so important to me is because I saw it as paradigmatic for sort of my own journey. I did not identify with the sort of erudite theologian Jesus. I identified much more with these sort of sad and confused disciples. The reason why was because I myself was sort of emerging from a really terrible bout of depression. A bout of depression that had called into question a lot of things in my life. My hopes, I was in the middle of a doctoral program. I was like, I don't know if I can keep doing this. It called into question a lot of things. And of course, as a theologian, and a Christian, it called into question a lot of things that I had thought about suffering and about God. What I did in the subsequent 3 years, what I have been doing, what I've continued to do here in Collegeville, is talk to other people to sort of engage their reinterpretations of Christianity in light of this crisis of depression that I had experienced in my life and that they had experienced in their life. So what I want to do today is sort of introduce you to some of the reinterpretations of depression, these theological reinterpretations that I've encountered in the last 3 years as I sort of journey along this road in search of a different account of suffering and a different account of other theological issues related to it. So I'm going to do that by telling you three stories, three sort of theological reinterpretations of depression that are particularly predominant or that I've found particularly compelling. The first one is that depression is a sin, that it's sinful. The second is that depression is the result of what theologians call natural evil. The third, which is probably the most unfamiliar, is that depression is a form of what I'm calling morally neutral suffering. And then finally, once I sort of introduce you to these three different accounts of depression from a Christian perspective, I'll talk a little bit about some sort of personal and pastoral implications of these stories. And hopefully, I will not talk so long that we don't have time for conversation, because I'm looking forward to hearing your thoughts about all of this. Two brief sort of side notes before I jump in. The first is I want to say from the beginning, I don't plan in my sort of prepared remarks to talk at all tonight about suicide. which, as many of us know, is a real part of many people's experiences of depression. Simply due to the limitations of time that I have right now, I haven't addressed that. But if that's something you'd like to talk about, we can hopefully do that in the question and answer. The second thing that I always try and mention when I talk about this with other people is that we're gathered here today to engage this topic for lots of different reasons. And one thing that I find is that often after sort of grappling with these difficult mental health issues, people have questions about either theological resources or mental health resources in their community, because this strikes a chord either with something that they're personally going through, or maybe you have friends or family members that you'd like to pass along resources to. Feel free after the talk to come and talk to me about that if that's something you're interested in, and I'd be happy to help with that. I didn't want to forget to mention that as we jump in. So, first, I want to talk to you about this interpretation of depression that sort of Carla already mentioned in the introductory remarks, and that you may have seen on the flyer for this event, this idea that depression is sinful, that depression is a sin or sort of the result of sin in people's lives. This, while there's a variety of ways in which people kind of come to this conclusion, there are two basic premises, sort of theological assumptions, that ground this view of depression. The first is that depression is against the will of God. In other words, it's bad, right? The second one is that the sufferer, him or herself, is personally responsible for his suffering. So we can think about this with like an analog to greed, for instance, something we in the Christian tradition identify as a sin. Greed is against the will of God. It's bad. We recognize it as bad. And if I'm greedy, I'm personally responsible for it. When we say that it's a sin, we mean that I sort of have some responsibility in doing it, and also that I'm responsible for not doing it, right? I have some freedom and agency in this particular act. So it's similar. These two premises are sort of similar and operative when people talk about depression as a sin. So as Carla said, over 30%, 31.4% of Christians in a study done by a psychologist, Matthew Stanford, here in the US in the last 10 years or so, 31.4% of them said that their churches made them feel that mental illness was the result of a personal sin. So it was something that they had done that had led to this feeling of depression. Okay. This tends to be a more predominant view in evangelical circles as well as Pentecostal circles. Having said that, just the other day, a monk here at the Abbey told me that for 30 years he's been hearing confessions, and people are constantly confessing that depression is something that they struggle with, and they present it as a sort of sin that they're dealing with. So I think while the numbers are lower in Catholic circles and Anglican circles, for instance, I don't think it's absent, this particular view. One reason why this view is so predominant is because a lot of very public figures in American Christianity are espousing it. So one philosopher of religion, Anastasia Scruton, did a survey, sort of not a social scientific survey, but an ad hoc survey of Christian websites, sort of looking at how mental health issues were treated there. And time again, depression was attributed to unbiblical choices or sinful choices. Similarly, in a very rigorous academic study, a Christian psychologist named Marcia Webb surveyed a huge set of best-selling Christian self-help books. Ones by people like Joyce Meyer here, whose face you might recognize even if you haven't read her books. And time again, these books prescribed that people who are suffering from depression need to confess their sins and sort of repent in order to get rid of depression. The implication, of course, being that it was sort of their fault, they had done something, and it was within their own personal agency to get rid of it, okay? One interesting illustration of this that I found was in an interview with Kay Jamison. Kay Jamison is one of the leading scholars, but also memoirists of depression. She writes about her experiences of bipolar. And she said that 20 years ago, when she published her memoir, An Unquiet Mind, she received a slew of letters from readers who were telling her, as I put here, that she deserved the illness because she was insufficiently Christian and the devil had gotten hold of her. Yeah, rightly so, we sort of shake our heads, like the audacity of strangers to write this woman who's written this beautiful, vulnerable memoir. The thing that gets me about this particular anecdote, though, is that I suspect that these Christians wrote her because they thought they were doing her a favor. They so believed that that all people are responsible for their own depression, that if only Kay Jamison realized she just needed to be a better Christian, then all her suffering would sort of dissipate. Okay. So I want to stay on this I want to stay on this possibility that people are trying to be helpful when they espouse this view, either helpful to themselves or helpful to other people, and say a little bit about why this view of depression might actually be appealing to people. Because I think there are some important reasons why people hang on to this, and it's important to understand them to sort of address this theologically. So I'm going to do that by addressing these two premises that I said are sort of underlying this view of depression. So first, this idea that depression is contrary to the will of God. This sort of assumption is, I think, not that far-fetched, particularly in our culture where when we hear the word depression, when we talk about depression, we're talking about a very harrowing experience. For those of you who aren't that familiar with depression, it's most often what's known as a chronic and recurring condition. Chronic because it's long. There are long episodes or spells of depression that many people have. And recurring in that people might have one of these long spells and then go a time where it sort of lessens in severity and then it reappears and is more severe again. So with what's called major depression or unipolar depression, which is the kind of depression probably most of us think of when we hear this word. I kind of think of it as like people are steady and then they have a spell where it's difficult and then they're more steady again and a spell that's more difficult. With bipolar depression where people have mania with it, it's often sort of people are steady, then they have a manic episode and then a depressive episode, and then they're more steady. This is a generalization, but the point is to illustrate that it's sort of this sort of cyclical condition that people have with periods of severity and less severe episodes. But when we hear the word depression, when we talk about it, both medically as well as sort of in the vernacular, when we hear depression, we think of the lows, right? We think of this terrible, severe suffering. Some of the sort of symptoms of depression that are probably a little bit more complex than what you're used to hearing about include the sort of loss of interest or pleasure, a loss of agency. People don't feel able to sort of perform even basic tasks. A loss of sense of futurity. Sometimes we talk about this as a loss of hope. People can't perceive tomorrow, not to mention perceiving that tomorrow will be better. A loss of interpersonal connection. Sometimes we think of this as a loss of empathy, but really it's in many ways more profound than that. It's a lack of even an ability to connect with other people that they used to, and a lack of meaningfulness. So when we list these things, we can start to see why people would say that this is contrary to the will of God. It seems contrary to everything that we think of as good. Of course God wouldn't want this for me. It's the loss of everything that's so good. And you start to see this also in the language that people use to talk about these depressive lows. They talk about it as a living death, as hell, as a purgatory sometimes, Even non-religious people use demon language. The whole idea being that they feel as if it is somehow apart from what God intends for themselves. So again, I don't think it's that hard for us to understand why people would think that this condition is contrary to the will of God. What I think is more complicated is this issue of personal responsibility. Why would people think that people that sufferers are responsible for this thing that is contrary to the will of God? So I'm going to give you some reasons why. The first one, I know the picture is distracting, I shouldn't have said that. The first one is that we live in a time where Christian imperatives to joy are everywhere. We hear Philippians, rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I say rejoice. Even our beloved Pope, who I really do love, is always talking about how Christians need to be joyful. I was talking to, where is she, Nancy. I was talking to Nancy recently, apparently in Pope Francis's Ash Wednesday reflection, he said that we should fast from sadness and put on joy. When Pope Francis says these things, he's not saying don't be depressed, right? We can assume that he has a more nuanced understanding of depression than that. However, most of the times when we hear these imperatives, there's not a lot of context to them. And so one of the fears that I have is that Christians are given the impression, one, that they always are supposed to be happy if they're sufficiently Christian. And second, because these are often presented in imperatives, it suggests that they're commands that we have the ability to respond to. I can simply will to be joyful or happy, or in this case, not depressed. I think that's sometimes how it's interpreted. And again, I could say more about how I don't think that's what Pope Francis means, but I think in the way it's circulated, that can often give that impression. Another reason why people might believe that depression is a sin is because one of the symptoms of depression is guilt. People feel incredibly guilty and sinful, not for any particular reason. It's just a very commonly known symptom. And so if you tell somebody who's depressed that their depression is because they did something wrong, the likelihood that they have a Rolodex of everything they've ever done wrong in their lives is very high. And so in that sense, their experience of depression confirms this theological belief, which makes people particularly vulnerable. And secondly, and sort of counterintuitively, if you tell someone that they are responsible for their depression, you're also implying that they can do something about it, right? That they can repent and become a better Christian, and then the depression will go away. And so in this sense, some people actually interpret this as a very hopeful message. If I just try harder, I won't be depressed anymore. I have this depiction here of Steve Harvey because I read an interesting article about him the other day. He has struggled with depression, and he was telling the audience of the article that the way he avoids the recurrence of his depression is that every morning he wakes up and he prays prayers of gratitude to God. And he believes that if he prays as many prayers of gratitude as he can, that he will not be depressed, because he says gratitude is incompatible with depression. So again, it's this idea that if he only does enough, if he's only a good enough Christian, then he can sort of stave off his depression, which is the sin. Okay, so that I think is a big, there's a counterintuitive hopefulness actually in this view. Having said that, all of you are like squirming in your chairs. It's not going to surprise you that there are some problems, I think, with this particular depression. While it does a lot of work for people, and I think it's important to acknowledge that, not to be so quick to dismiss it, because it does do some work for people, it also has some problems. The first one I want to raise sort of troubles this assumption that depression is necessarily against the will of God, and troubles this issue of the imperative to Christian happiness. Okay? Marcia Webb, a psychologist who I mentioned earlier, works in sort of mainline and evangelical Christian circles. And this is something she hears all the time, that it's a sin to be a Christian and be sad. And so one of the things that she did was she just went through the Bible and started pulling out all these instances when very holy people have what she recognizes as some form of psychological distress. It would be anachronistic to say that they were depressed in the way that we sort of today understand it, but she's saying there, just as there are imperatives to joy in the scriptures and happiness and all of that, there are also times when holy people, Jesus, for example, cries at the loss of a friend or is totally distraught in the Garden of Gethsemane. So she said, if that is what leads people to think that this is a sin, then, you know, it's biblically unfounded and is really, a very narrow understanding of the Christian life that can be suffocating. Two, this really gets at this issue of responsibility and personal responsibility. So as I said, yeah, responsibility for sin requires freedom, right? It's not a sin if I have no choice but to do it. If I'm forced to do something, it's not a sin. I didn't have freedom to do it. This is sort of just basic understandings of responsibility, but also of sin. Depression sufferers often do not have control over their depression, do not have control over many aspects of their life, or at least have an incredibly diminished sense of agency when they're in this condition. I think this is one of the hardest things to understand about depression for those who don't experience it. Because when we typically experience fluctuations in mood, we also often retain a sense that we can sort of give ourselves a pep talk and get out of it, right? So people tell people with depression, look on the bright side, or like, go do something nice for yourself and this will just get better. Like, there's this idea that if people just try hard enough, they can sort of fix it. In depression, it's not that there's just a lack of desire to do things that would be good for them or sort of life-giving. It's that possibility is no longer present in one's experience of the world. For example, people often associate depression with not wanting to get out of bed in the morning. Typically, people think, oh, well, I'm tired. I don't want to get out of the bed in the morning either. Like, what's this depressed person's problem? Just like, will yourself to do it. People with depression often talk about how it's not that they don't want to. Often they do want to. It's just not a possibility with how they experience the world. One example, a personal one that I think of, is one of the things I really struggled to do at the worst of my depression was to read. And books have been my sanctuary. They're not only my sort of career work, they're a sanctuary to me, but I could not read. So it wasn't just a matter of will. And so this idea that depression is a sin, that people have sort of agency over their experience, really overlooks one of the sort of trademark characteristics of depression, which is this severely diminished experience of agency that really troubles any idea that people have responsibility over what they're going through. Okay, last one for this one. So another caution that arises when people talk about depression as a sin is this awareness that calling depression a sin bolsters the social stigmatization of depression that already exists. So an analog to this that we might be more familiar with is the idea of calling homosexuality a sin, right? Regardless of your views about that, most of us are probably familiar with the ways in which that view of sexuality, that it's a sin, has been a justification for the marginalization, discrimination, violence against LGBTQ people in broader society. And what a lot of people are saying, particularly mental health activists, is that if we continue to carelessly call depression a sin, we're offering theological grounds to continue to discriminate and marginalize people with mental health conditions. So that's another reason, particularly for theologians and Christians who believe that our practices and beliefs as Christians should be conducive to abundant life. It sort of puts on a red flag when you're espousing beliefs that in this particular context seem to feed into oppression and discrimination. All right. So often when people are trying to argue against this view that depression is a sin, they often cite this next interpretation of depression, which is that depression is the result of natural evil, or that it is a natural evil. So I'll say a little bit about what that means. Similarly with these sort of premises. So the view that depression is a natural evil, it's similar to our first interpretation in that it sees depression as a bad thing. And it does for all the same reasons as the other one before. Because when we think depression, we think all these sort of terrible symptoms that are antithetical to human flourishing. However, in this view, it attributes depression not to personal responsibility, not to the will and freedom of the sufferer, but rather to sort of fluctuations in the natural world. In this way, it likens depression to earthquakes or sort of natural floods or viruses, right? These are just things that happen that are terrible, that are a result of how the world functions sort of naturally. So in the case of depression, when you hear Christians talk about depression as being the result of genetics, or depression as being the result of a chemical imbalance in the brain, or the makeup of your gut bacteria, these sort of scientific explanations for it, often theologians take those and they use that to claim that depression is the result of natural evil, something in nature that happens. While there is no what we might say is official sort of Roman Catholic view of depression, there have been official initiatives to address depression and other mental health issues. The most widely cited is an address that Pope John Paul II gave in, I think it was 1996, at a gathering of Catholic healthcare workers at the Vatican who were trying to talk about mental illness. So I'll read very quickly just a brief excerpt here because it kind of gives you a sense of how he understands this condition and how it might fit into this interpretation. He says, "Christ took all human suffering on himself, even mental illness. Yes, even this affliction, which perhaps seems the most absurd and incomprehensible, configures the sick person to Christ and gives him a share in his redeeming passion." So you'll see here that I've colored in red this language of illness, mental illness, and this idea of the sick person. He's presenting these conditions as a medical condition, right? That may be because he's talking to a bunch of healthcare professionals. It also may be because that's how he sees it, like many of us do in this sort of, you know, post-Enlightenment 21st century, that it's a medical condition, okay? And as a medical condition, we can understand it sort of in this category of natural evil, like viruses and other sort of diseases. Again, I already said, if we view it as a disease, as a sort of natural evil, the evil part of it, the evil part of natural evil, is really attributed to how difficult the experience itself is, like the one before. Another reason why this is such a compelling view is because it really pushes back against the claim of personal responsibility. So that's illustrated here with this quote, "I am not crazy or bad or lacking in faith or in discipline. I have a disease. It's called depression." So you can see how it's really pushing back against the sin argument, right? This is Kathy Cronkite, the daughter of Walter Cronkite, who you may remember as an actress and has spent much of her life as a mental health advocate. Another reason why people want to attribute depression to the natural world, or why it's appealing, I should say, is that it also kind of entails a very hopeful message, right? We live in a context where we're constantly making scientific progress. And so if we can pinpoint a sort of natural cause for depression, it can be means for a lot of hope. You know, if it's a chemical imbalance in the brain, we can take drugs that adjust the chemical imbalance. Or if it's genetics, we can alter genes. So there's a certain sort of scientific hope that comes along with this particular interpretation of depression as well. So, like the other account of depression, I'm going to introduce some of the cautions, some of the resistances that have arisen in response to this particular account of depression as a natural evil. So the first is has to do with the precarity of a lot of the medical science about depression. While we have a variety, a real assortment of drugs and treatments that are used to help people manage depression, there's very little sort of consistent, concrete evidence to explain what depression is, actually. So think of like cancer. We have a sense that it's these, you know, infinitely expanding cells in the body, and we develop treatments accordingly. It's kind of been the opposite. We're stuck in the opposite sort of relationship with depression, where we've found a bunch of different things that affect depression and how people experience it, but we still don't know exactly what it is. Because of that, it's very, very difficult to treat medically. And while that in and of itself is just a reality, a fact of life, one thing that certain sort of cultural theorists, as well as a lot of psychologists, are concerned about is that if we have this sort of black and white medical understanding of depression, that it might lead people to put too much faith in a cure in a way that actually might prevent them from exploring other sort of mental health care options, whether that's psychotherapy, things like that. They might actually take drugs that have really detrimental side effects and not have adequate help in negotiating those things. So again, this is not at all to say that these treatments are bad or that the depression can't be treated medically. It's just that people are concerned that if we theologically decide preemptively that it's a disease, that we might be sort of reducing treatment options for people and also preemptively excluding certain theological possibilities because of the sort of dominance of this medical view. Second, this view of depression as a natural evil doesn't help us avoid this problem of social stigma. Part of this is tied to the language of evil itself, I think. If we call it a natural evil, we're still saying that it's an evil. We're still saying that it's absolutely antithetical to human flourishing. And while some people have appealed to disease as a way to combat stigma, right? We heard Kathy Cronkite say, it's not my fault, like don't stigmatize me, it's a disease, I can't help it. There's a long history of how certain medical conditions have been stigmatized in this country, and sort of mental health issues are at the forefront of how medical frameworks have been used to stigmatize people. So there's a lot of sort of caution in the mental health care community about whether calling depression a disease actually gets us out of the problem of stigmatization, because it's still seen as a sort of deviant form of existence. Then finally, the third caution is that this idea of depression as a natural evil reduces the experience of depression to its very worst. I want to say a little bit about this because this is more complicated and is going to engage some of the more recent interdisciplinary work that I'm doing. So, as I said before, depression is this chronic and cyclical experience. It's different for every person, but typically, the sort of most common experience is that it's a condition that lasts throughout a person's life. I often think of how people talk about alcoholics, that even when you're not drinking, you're still an alcoholic. There's this sense with depression that even when you're not in the bottom of the pit, even when you're not at your most severe, you're still managing depression. You're still, even when you're sort of evened out, you're in what people often refer to as recovery, you're still coping with the reality of depression in your life. The symptoms may not be as intense, but it's always sort of there as a part of your existence. Increasingly, some scholars are trying to sort of expand our understanding of what depression is to include these in-between periods. To put it another way, they want to sort of resist the temptation to reduce depression as something that is only this sort of living death set of symptoms, to include the sort of fluctuations between severe episodes as well. And a lot of this is based on the fact that people with depression experience it as this sort of in this range of experience, looking for the right word, like they don't just experience the worst of it, they experience the fluctuations. And people are looking for ways to talk about the presence of depression when it's not just at its worst. One of the people who were sort of the first scholars to do that was this social psychologist named David Karp. And he uses a lot of qualitative methods for his research. And so he started talking and interviewing people with depression. And what he found was that they were very eager to contextualize the worst of their experiences of depression within a larger narrative of their illness. So he started to talk about this as a process view of depression. So he, in this, it entailed not only the worst, but also a sort of more capacious sense of depression that sufferers started to associate their recovery, their experience of depression in recovery, alongside their experience of depression at its worst. In my research, I kind of talk about this by using three different moments that reoccur in narratives of depression. I use a lot of a memoir in my research to sort of understand what the experience of depression is like. And what you find is that this right here, what I call the sort of living death experience of depression, that's the worst of depression. That's what we often think when we think depression, just that. But in these narratives of depression, people also associate their or describe their experience of depression through this period that I call survival, which is when it's pretty bad, but it's being managed through intense support systems. So that might include hospitalization, it might include medication, it might include the sort of intensive support of loved ones. The experience of depression when there's a sort of stable support system, they say, is different than when they're at their worst and it seems like, you know, there's no way to go on because they have no support and no resources. This experience of sort of managed severity that I call survival gives way to what I call situational flourishing, which is what some people in the more medical literature talk about as recovery. So people who sort of endure a severe bout of depression often say, I'm never the same as I used to be. I can't do all the things that I used to do. There's still some sort of lingering effects and symptoms of depression. However, I can find goodness in my life. I've recovered some things that I lost. I may not be the same. I may not be able to do the same thing, but I can still have a good life with this depression. And I have it here represented in a cycle because, as I said, it's this sort of cyclical condition that somebody who sort of goes through recovery or is in this period of situational flourishing might then have another very severe episode. They might come out of that again, Some people have it and, you know, have a severe episode and they never sort of have such a severe episode again. So this is the best way I could represent that. But the idea here is that in this process view of depression that Karp is proposing, it expands our understanding of depression not only to be the very worst, which is the sort of living death, but sort of this whole process of living with and coping with depression. The thing about this more capacious view of depression is I think that it pushes back against our understandings of depression as a natural evil. It pushes back against the idea that depression is only something that is antithetical to life, that it's only the very worst of the condition. And I was convinced of this in large part through the stories of people with depression that I read. One of them that I wanted to sort of give you a glimpse into her story is a theologian named Monica Coleman. This book was published last year. It's a memoir of her life with bipolar II. She has a couple books, so I'm gonna pull quotes from both of them, but the idea with kind of reading this to you, I want you to hear in her own words the sort of complexity of her experience of depression and how her view of it changes from this sort of living death experience of depression to one that is more of what I'd recognize as a process view of depression. And I'm hoping to show how some of her narration of it pushes back against the categorization of depression as evil. So I'll read it to you. Oop. Okay. Depression runs a number on one's normal character. It takes something from you. Depression makes you something else, someone other than who you know yourself to be, a shadow of another self. A self who, at one time, made friends and could speak in complete sentences. In its place, however, is a mere shell of that self. Yes, there are times when I barely recognize myself. So I feel like in this quote, you really get a sense of the depth, that sort of living death experience, depression as loss of the things that she once knew to be good, in life and good about herself. But she goes on. I remember the day my therapist asked me to stop thinking of depression as an enemy. I cut my eyes at her and scowled. Are you joking? Something inside of me can take me out, and I'm not supposed to fight it? Author and teacher Parker Palmer writes of this cogently in his book, Let Your Life Speak. He recalls a therapist saying, "You seem to look upon depression as the hand of an enemy trying to crush you. Do you think you could see it instead as the hand of a friend pressing you down to ground on which it is safe to stand?" Friend? Could a depressive condition be a friend? Could it be a part of myself to explore, to understand, to accept? It's taken me years to stretch my original understanding of depression to one that refuses to go to war against my own body. So here you see, at the beginning of the quote, Dr. Coleman talks about her depression as sort of this invasive species, this sort of enemy that she's at battle with. And this resonates, I think, very much with this idea of depression as an evil. But by the end of this, she says her understanding of depression has stretched to be something that is actually just a part of who she is, that does not warrant this sort of battle, this sort of enemy battle, but is rather integrated into who she is in this way, I think, that really pushes back against our understandings of evil. She goes on, it took me 3 years and a lot of therapy to stop fighting. I had to stop fighting the fact that I wasn't going to get back what I lost. I could remember who I was, but I could not go back to being that woman. When you come back from the dead, you aren't the same person. So Coleman, being the theologian that she is, at the end of this starts to sort of play with some resurrection imagery that I think is really interesting. Because on one hand, she's not denying the sort of loss of depression, the sort of death dimensions of it. But in accepting it as a part of herself, accepting it as a sort of ongoing presence in her life, she's actually able to associate it with something that within the Christian tradition is very positive, right? Resurrection. So implicit in this image, she's saying that this ongoingness of depression can be something that she sees as a part of her good self, as a sort of resurrection self. So again, what I'm arguing here is that when we have this stretched understanding of depression, as Coleman puts it, one that isn't just reducing this mental health condition to its very worst, but is rather looking at how people are actually living with less severe iterations of it in their lives and incorporating it into their lives as something that can be at least a neutral part of who they are. It's not a romantic vision of depression, to be sure, but that it's just a sort of limitation that is present in their life, that it really pushes back against this idea that it's evil, that it's necessarily sort of antithetical to human flourishing. So what I want to do is, let me say this. For me, in my journey of studying depression, stories like Monica Coleman's posed a huge challenge to me. To go back to the sort of image of the story of Emmaus, a sort of analogy, when I kept running into people like Coleman's, it would stop me in my tracks. And I'd be like, wait a minute. How can depression be something that is not just totally bad and antithetical? So what I set out for then, in light of that, was an answer to this question. Can we conceive of a form of suffering, in this case depression? Can we in the Christian tradition conceive of a form of suffering that is not inherently good, because I don't want to romanticize it, right? But also is not reducible to evil? Because I think in the Christian tradition, we have a long history of romanticizing suffering. And once people started to realize that that's not a good way to go, we've sort of gone the other extreme, which is all suffering is necessarily bad and evil. Is there some way to talk about some forms of suffering in another way, in this case, depression? So one sort of resource that I found from this comes from some very recent scholarship in theology and science. In particular, theologians who are looking at suffering in conversation with evolutionary theory. So I want to introduce you to some of the resources on this interpretation of suffering and suggest the ways in which this might help us think about depression in a theological way, but one that's sort of avoids the pitfalls of these other stories about depression. So again, I kind of tried to break this down in two premises. This idea that depression is morally neutral suffering, we could also say morally ambiguous suffering. Some people call it natural suffering. So this would understand depression as, again, not inherently good, but also not reducible to evil. That's the sort of morally neutral or morally ambiguous dimension. And usually, particularly if we're looking at this from the sort of evolutionary conversation, people who are looking at this type of suffering would say that it arises from fluctuations in the natural world, in culture, and that those things can be attributed. I actually think for the case of depression, we can sort of bracket that. It doesn't necessarily matter where it comes from with this morally neutral view. What's more at stake is that it can't be reduced to evil. So one of the leading thinkers on this right now is a feminist theologian at Fordham named Elizabeth Johnson, who wrote this book, Ask the Beasts, in which she does a close reading of Darwin's evolutionary theory and tries to bring that into conversation with contemporary theology. Particularly, one issue she engages is this issue of suffering. And she says from the outset, if we take Darwin's theory of evolution seriously, then things like pain and suffering are not an aberration from how the world was made, but is rather a sort of part of how the world functions. And when we look at it from that perspective, we can also start to recognize that things like pain and suffering and death, things that from a Christian perspective we automatically associate with evil, that actually from an evolutionary standpoint, pain and suffering and death have really difficult dimensions in our experience of them, but they also sort of serve a beneficiary purpose in our lives, right? Pain is, it sucks, pain sucks, but it also helps us learn what is good for us and what is bad for us as creatures, right? She talks about how in the larger view of the community of creation, the death of one generation is necessary for the next generation to arise. So already from this evolutionary standpoint, she starts to point out ways in which things that we automatically assume are evil can actually not only serve us individually, but serve the larger community in ways that have often been overlooked. So she starts to sort of tease out different types of suffering as a consequence of this. She wants to hold on to the fact that there are forms of suffering that are absolutely evil and sinful, what we might recognize as moral suffering. But then instead of just categorizing everything else as natural evil, she says we also need to talk about a sort of morally neutral suffering. That is suffering that is just a part of our existence as creatures. Every creature has limitation and pain and death. And maybe we need to start talking about that as just a sort of morally neutral suffering, something that's necessary as a part of the world as it is, rather than something that is evil, okay? So it's a renaming of sorts, but I think done so in a larger context, a larger view of creation that, again, helps us to see that it's not just semantics. It's not just that she's calling the same thing morally neutral suffering instead of natural evil. She's actually pointing out the ways in which our experiences of pain and suffering sometimes can't be reduced to evil. So what I want to suggest to you, as I hurry up and finish so we can talk, is that I actually, as it stands right now, with where I am in the conversation about theology and depression, I find this interpretation of suffering to be very, very compelling. Very compelling based on the narratives of depression that I've sort of been living with for the last couple of years, compelling for the ways that they sort of obviate the problems of the other stories of depression that I've touched on. So I want to say, just sum up a little bit of why it's compelling. So already I've said this view of suffering avoids the sort of positive and negative extremes. I think it allows us a way to talk about depression where it doesn't romanticize it. It doesn't deny that sort of living death dimension of it. But it also doesn't reduce depression to that. It allows for the contextualization and the sort of expansion of depressive experience that we actually see in the way that people live it. So as I say, it's sort of more capacious. I also think that this view of suffering helps us to avoid these tricky problems of victim blaming and social stigma. So obviously it's not attributing depression to the fault of the depression suffering necessarily. It also is just saying this is not some evil thing that's a part of your life. It's at the very, very basic level just a fact of your life, the sort of morally neutral part of it. So there isn't the same tendency or the temptation to victim blame. Similarly, it's not as vulnerable, I think, to the sort of social stigma problem that I've already talked about. And then practically speaking, I think this view of depression invites us more naturally into different types of personal and pastoral questions. So I'll just go through some of these really quickly. I think when we look at depression as a sin or the result of sin or as something that's evil, it feeds questions like these over here. So what have I done wrong? What have they done wrong to deserve this condition? How do I get rid of this? It's only a problem that needs fixing. Why am I destined to this evil condition? Why are other people destined to it? Those are legitimate theological questions, but for people living with a chronic and recurring condition, it can be a sort of endless loop where there's not a lot of answers for these questions. And I think if we look at it as a form of morally neutral suffering, we have other sort of more constructive theological questions and pastoral questions that arise, like, you know, how can I live well with the limitations that we have in life? How can we lessen the living death dimensions of this condition and live more in the sort of situational flourishing dimensions of it? How is God working amid this condition? If it's not reducible to evil, where it might open our eyes in ways to see God's work in different ways. And then how can we support others so they can live as well as possible with this condition? So it sort of brackets some of the moral pitfalls, and I think practically is much more functional. There are some cautions. As I say, I'm more convinced of this, but quickly, there are some people that are just gonna disagree with me that there are forms of suffering that can't be reduced to evil. Some people might say that this process view that I'm proposing is overly optimistic, that it doesn't do justice to just how overwhelming the living death dimensions of depression are. Some people might also say that this can lead, this is Christian masochism, a sort of other version of a sort of romanticization of depression. I'll leave with this note. In general, from my experiences personally and sort of pastorally and working on mental health issues, I just want to emphasize that I think the stories we tell about suffering really, really matter. It's often in when people are in crisis, sort of like the disciples on the road to Emmaus, that we actually get to have direct conversations about suffering with people. And it's also in times when people are in crisis that it's the most difficult to have these conversations because people are just like desperate for whatever seems comfortable and is meaningful in that moment, right? We've probably experienced this from our friendships and things like that. But the stories that people cling to when they're in crisis come from somewhere. And what I often find when people are saying things like, my depression is a sin, it's my fault, I often wonder, where did this come from? And isn't it a shame that they didn't encounter another interpretation of suffering before they were at rock bottom? And so I want to forefront that because I think that it's really important that we introduce to our friends, to our congregations, that we introduce stories of suffering to them thoughtfully so that those conversations don't only happen when people are sort of desperate and in crisis. So with that, I hope we have a couple more minutes so we can talk. Thank you so much for letting me share with you. Chris.
I really appreciate that this is the story, The Road to Emmaus. It's the story I'm using for my integration project that I'll be presenting in a month.
But, oh, that's great.
It's really struck me tonight that that he was made known to them in the breaking of the bread. And sometimes we call ourselves the body of Christ, and we talk about this as the body of Christ. I just wanted to share that with you and with the group of, that somehow Jesus was made known to them in the brokenness in the moment. So I wanted to thank you for that.
Yeah, thank you. And it strikes me, I mean, there's a lot with the brokenness. That scene also strikes me as this very communal image, right? Breaking bread is a sort of great image of community. And one of the things that time and time again I've come back to in this research is that we think of depression as a very individualistic condition because, you know, it's my depression, it's your depression. We experience it as individuals, but actually to live in into depression in a way that is survivable, that is such that we can actually live well with this condition, absolutely requires other people. It requires community. And I think that's also sort of lost sometimes in our conversations. And I think is a real challenge to the way that the church doesn't really deal with mental health. Of all places, the church should be a community that can support that, but doesn't. So I really appreciate that.
Thank you so much for just a marvelous journey through this territory. Part of me loved what you meant with that claim that, you know, having a different starting point for people's experience of mental sickness, illness, anything like that in the Christian tradition. And in large part, I wonder if the root of the problem is the traditional Christian theodicy project, trying to explain God's relationship to suffering.
Yeah.
So that has me wondering if in your research you came across a very different avenue where we absolutely accept that the sufferer of depression is innocent, never guilty, always with the victim, and that there were protesting theologies, protesting against God, even a God who has used the evolutionary project for God's created world, a God who has a world in which there is so much innocent suffering, is a God who has given us voices of protest, even against God's self. I just wonder if you came across protesting voices against God.
Yeah. So the closest, the most like clearly protest voice is actually Monica Coleman, who I used. In part, I think, because she's a theologian, so she's aware of these conversations about the sort of implications of our theologies of suffering for how we understand God. She is a process theologian and attributes much of her conversion to process thought. This idea, simply put, this idea theologically that God sort of suffers with us, that God is sort of entangled and responsive to what we're going through. That became very, very important to her because of how her experience of suffering challenged her assumptions about a sort of omnipotent, you know, all-powerful God. One of the problems, I would venture to say, with a lot of the Christian literature on just depression is that it's not written by theologians. And I hate to say that because it sounds so arrogant. I mean that only that some of these questions that you as a theologian have about the implications of these views, they're just questions that aren't being raised so directly. And there's not as many resources often at people's fingertips to grapple with them because there's a lack of theological sort of resources in their lives. So I'm hoping it's definitely issues that have come up for me personally that I think need to be addressed, but it's not addressed so much in the literature. Ben?
First, thank you so much, Jess. This was wonderful, and I really appreciate all the really illuminating work that you're doing here, especially the last third where this is a really compelling model for you. My question has to do with the move to moral neutrality with regard to suffering. Moral neutrality is a tricky business, theologically speaking. In fact, just off the top of my head, I can't name another instance where moral neutrality is a tenable position. But there is a long and storied tradition of paradoxical good and evil standing together. For example, just Luther's approach to the human condition, right? So why the move to neutrality and not reducible to evil rather than acknowledging experience of evil in addition to experiences also of good? I'm not saying that you should do that, but
yeah.
I would imagine that you've thought about this, and where does that come from?
Yeah, I mean, I think part of my answer has to do with the context in which I'm working. Like I said, I think that so much of the work on suffering is so quick to go to evil that I didn't feel like it was important to hold on to. It was important to hold on to that. That was just going to be a trap. It's interesting though. I would be interested to hear more about these other sort of resources that you're pointing to. I haven't thought about them so much. So I'm simply saying I think there's a reason why I wasn't gravitating towards them. Yeah, I'll leave it. I had another thing, but I lost it, so I'll leave it there.
My question is very closely related to Ben's, and it is a theological question. Are you advocating that Christian theologians abandon the idea of natural evil? Or are you arguing that Christian theologians abandon the idea of natural evil in this case, and it may be in other cases?
Yeah, I've been thinking about this, so I don't have a conclusive answer. Part of me is like, I was looking at Elizabeth Johnson's work, and I was like, I think she abandons it. And so in light of that, I was thinking, do I want to abandon it? So I think that, I think right now I'm leaning towards abandoning it in light of the fact that I think a lot of things that have been attributed to natural evil in light of this evolutionary work has simply been shown to be something much more closer to what she's pointing to as morally neutral. Also, I think this is a slightly different theological conversation, but I think natural evil becomes a really hard concept now that we're living in the Anthropocene, now that human beings have impacted every single inch of this globe so dramatically, that all these natural disasters that we used to attribute to natural evil are now clearly entangled with moral evil. So that's like a different theological conversation that's made me question it from that angle, and now this scholarship's making me question it from another angle. So I'm undecided still. I was just pondering this today, but I'd be curious to hear if you have a reason to hang on to it.
Well, you can see that someone might say, if you're saying that, in this case, depression is not the result of natural evil, it's really related to the way the world is.
Yes.
But then I step back and I say, after I look at the way the world is in its manifold ways, why is it like that? And there are certain aspects of the world that strike me as being not the way I would have made the world.
Yeah.
So it seems to me you push the question back, but it's going to come back at you again in different form.
Yeah. I mean, I would say, first of all, to that I want to hang on to moral evil. So I would say it's a matter of disentangling those sometimes. Sometimes that's easier to do than others. So I want to hang on to moral evil and human responsibility for that. But I mean, what Johnson does is she kind of cites this best possible world theory where she says, we have grounds to believe as Christians that the reason why things are the way they are is because this is the best possible way that they could be. And that pain is a part of that and death is a part of that. Sin wasn't supposed to be a part of that, but that happened anyway. Carmel, did you want to jump in?
Saying, to me, it seems precisely the question that, you know, the way I want the world to be is being questioned in all of this. And also, the way I think God would like the world to be is being questioned. because you know many of us here, I'm sure, have got a disease of one in the other, and you know how do you see that as who you are?
Yeah.
You know, I've got a friend who has incredible cerebral palsy, and she shocked me one day when she said, "Oh, I'll have this in heaven. This is who I am." And you know, coming at it from a completely different angle, you know, but surely God will fix her, was my first thought. And in fact, that's me layering onto God what I, you know, see, which is really dissolving the entire mystery of everything.
Yeah.
And not holding on to this incredible tension of mystery in it all.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what I can sort of hear you're trying to do.
Yes. Yeah, that's absolutely right. I really appreciate the way you've articulated that. I mean, I think it comes down to this tension in a lot of, in all of Christianity. I mean, evil is a relative concept. It's the absence of good. And what we understand to be good at any given time is in flux. It's informed by lots of different things. It's informed by scripture, of course, but it's, I mean, our cultural understandings of health at any given time inform what we understand to be natural evil. And what I'm finding in these narratives is that over time, for many depression sufferers, a different understanding of health emerges. Or, I mean, to put it in theological terms, sort of human flourishing. That changes as people experience this, such that they're able to say, depression is a part of who I am, and there are dimensions of this experience that are conducive to my flourishing. In ways that would really push back, kind of like your friend, push back against a lot of our cultural assumptions about that.
Yeah, so one more hand, Kathleen. So we'll take her comment or question and then we'll
wrap.
Great.
I want to ask you about moral responsibility if you really, really want to let go of that. So what would you say to someone who is really done something wrong? Let's say I've really just treated Don just terribly, day in and day out, you know, and I just really feel bad about that. I'm sad.
Uh-huh.
Or, in the early monastic tradition, they had the language of dejection. I just really feel dejected about myself, my life, my actions. Or, let's say, I've really been traumatized by something, by an abusive situation, not from my husband, but, you know, an abusive parent, or and I'm sad, I'm dejected, I feel low, I feel my life is meaningless,
uh-huh.
It's purposeless. It has some of those characteristics. Okay, so you don't want to, I think, call that depression.
Correct.
You want to only use the term depression, I think, in the more medicalized view now, so that anything that is we're morally responsible for never leads to depression. It may lead to sadness or dejection. We have to have another vocabulary that there's not a, these are two distinctive things, morally responsible, morally neutral. By definition, there's not a, what am I trying to do
yeah.
with my hands?
Causal relationship or overlap Venn diagram.
So that I never, you don't want us to say, you know, I feel really depressed about what I've been doing to my partner. I feel really depressed about this abusive situation I've been in. Or it's led me to depression, or it's led me to feel depressed.
Mm-hmm.
That's an inaccurate use of the term, you're saying.
Yeah, or it's a different use of the term, I would say. Yes, that's correct.
But you're saying, because there's moral responsibility there, I've done something wrong, or somebody's done something wrong to me, you do not want to use the word depression to for us to describe our experiences.
I would say that's a different experience than what I'm talking about here. And let me say too that it's I let the experiences guide me in reaching that conclusion. It's not that I was like, I want to separate the moral causes from the non-moral causes. It was that time and time again when people are studying depression with these sort of thick descriptions that allow them to sort of differentiate this kind of condition from what you're talking about. There wasn't this sort of singular clear cause. There were people that had trauma, there were people that didn't. There were people that had trauma that never got depressed. Like, there wasn't these clear causal connections that so many of our Christian understandings of sin are dependent upon. Not all, of course, but a lot of them. And so it became important to me to sort of, separate somebody's moral life from their depression to the extent, or in defining it, I should say. Yeah. Oh, I gotta leave there. Yeah, thank you.